Liberty. We're starting the count. Okay, we're going to do a new one today. When the Saints go marching in, found some verses for them. So maybe you know it, maybe you don't. We'll learn together. So rise if you can and sing with me.
Oh, you would, please take your seats. I'd like to welcome you all to Liberty Baptist this morning. Welcome those joining us online. It's a little rainy and a little dreary, and looks like the November temperatures are here, but we'll deal with it. We'll begin with announcements. They're in your bulletins. The first one I need to make sure everybody knows, Susan was here early today. I didn't catch who was last today, so if anybody comes in late, then we'll shame them next morning. Get them. Yes, Barbara? Tuesday. Could you say that again?
Tuesday is over 55.
Tuesday is over 55. What time?
6 o'clock.
Okay. The other announcements, we do have the Harvest Party. That will be following service, so we hope you can stay. We've got a slide out there and several.
We've got lots of food and a ton of prizes for bingo. There's crafts. There are pumpkins. There's plenty of fun things to be done.
So plan on staying. I think Dan and Jack, is that who's going down the slide first?
I was thinking Brock and Jack. Yeah, Dan and Jack. Yes.
And
yep.
Are you okay with that, Dan? You're going down the slide first?
No. It's an obstacle course, so I really feel like Jack and Dan could set the beginning of that.
Neither one looked very enthused. No.
Yeah.
Oh, well.
I do have an online announcement. Tammy Hoppus says that she'll have a new sign-up sheet for nursery workers next week. So just look at your schedule, and we are grateful for everybody who contributes, because my child runs rogue, so.
See a couple costumes out there. Yours looks hideous, by the way, Eric. Okay, also remember that next week, November 5th, right after service, those who are reading in the Mariah's Book Club, you'll be having discussion after service. I believe there'll be some light food.
Yeah, we're going to do soups and salads, and Abby's going to make mac and cheese. We'll have some kind of dessert, too, so we'll eat and talk about the book.
Eat and talk about the book, The Red Letter. So there's still a few copies back there if someone thinks they can get the book done in a week, then please pick one up and stay for just a little bit after service next Sunday to discuss the book. Bible study will be Wednesday. That's at 6:30. We meet in the adult Sunday school classroom. So plan on coming there if you can. And any other announcements from the floor? All right, if there are no others, then we'll go on to Happy Dollars.
I think Gabe might have a Happy Dollar. No, I said I think Gabe might have a Happy Dollar. No, you don't? Oh, sorry, I misunderstood. Oh, he had an announcement?
That was a definite no. Hi, Marshmallow.
Poop team, they won again.
Yes.
And Christy has a birthday this week, Halloween, and she was 12 before she found out they weren't celebrating her birthday.
Well, happy birthday. Yeah.
So Maren has primary prom, so I'm sure she's happy for that. And then my first middle school dance is the same Saturday, next Saturday.
Yeah. Thank you. Well, have fun. You're going to dance the night away? Is it a boogie dance or a waltz dance?
One more Sunday with my first cousin Becky before she heads back to Florida. And she got me here 2 Sundays in a row.
That's great for both of you and us. But be careful when you guys go back. Happy Halloween.
We're happy. We had a great time, the three of us, visiting New Ompaba, Florida last week. Eldon really likes the warm weather. I think that's part South African in. And I'm sure everyone knew, but South Africa was in the World Cup for rugby yesterday, and they won. Eric was very excited.
It's basically kickball for adults, that's all.
I have a couple. One is for Aaron. His football team won in the second round of sectionals. And so they've had two really close games that were really fun. And then one is for Abby's birthday is next week. And she's coming home so we can have a party. It'll be fun.
And Jesus.
Just like a little woman, she's taking the money out of the plate. And I saw Louisville won their football game yesterday. You owe another dollar, by the way.
And volleyball and football.
Just open up your purse. I'm a Purdue fan, so we don't get to put any money in. Anybody else? Well, the Deacon Fund thanks you for your dollars and your donations.
Oh, I have one more from online. Tammy Hoppus says, happy dollar for the time I just spent down in Florida with my cousin. I'm at the airport now waiting to come home. She had a cousin who's terminally ill from England, and she was able to come and visit potentially one last time. So they met down in Florida to visit. And the anticipation is this is the last time she'll get to see her cousin. So this is it's a prayer request, and a happy and a sad at the same time.
Any other announcements or happy dollars? All right, at this time we'll have our call to worship.
Let's join together in prayer. Gracious God, we thank you for today. Dare I say it in a room full of farmers, but I thank you for the moisture that enabled us to gather together today. Lord, we pray that the rest of this week is nice and dry so that harvesting can finish up for people. Lord, we pray that we feel your presence in this space, in our laughter, in the wiggles and costumes of munchkins, in the lessons we learn, and in the scripture we hear. Guide and direct our hearts so that our lives glorify and honor you. In your name we pray, amen. I'd like to invite our candle lighter up. Maddox, you wanna get those? Maddox is gonna, we will have candles in a moment. For now, just take a moment to reflect.
Thank you.
most eventful light in the candle. But I did notice the marshmallow man didn't come near the candle.
Yeah, he's safe. He's safe away from the fire.
Fire and graham crackers. All right, if you would, please bow your heads. Gracious Heavenly Father above, Lord, we are so thankful that we can be here today. And we just give you all the praise and all the glory. And even when we mess up, as in now, we thank you for the miscues, but we know that it is all in love of you and of each other, and that we can be here together. And Lord, we ask that you bless this offering that we're about to take and use it to further your word. In Jesus' precious name, amen.
Amen.
Hey, God can be glorified more times. It's fine. Yeah.
Heavenly Father, Lord, again, we don't say it often enough, but we thank you. We thank you for your love, for your mercy, and for all the many blessings that you bestow upon us. And Lord, we are just ever grateful for each and every one who is here and for the tithes and offerings that have been given. And we pray that it will be used in accordance with you and your word as we go about this week to further your love and your message. And just be with each of us. Give us knowledge, give us wisdom, and give us kindness and love and respect for others. In Jesus' precious name, amen.
I'd like to invite the children and children at heart up front for a message from Nan. Get ready for all of these cute little costumes, everybody.
You know, I think these little kids, I think you guys know more about running the church than the grown-ups do. I don't think we could, we couldn't have church without all you kids, because you know how to do it right, don't you? I want to hold these babies up. Hold him up so everyone can see his costume. Yeah, he's a bat. Be careful. And looky here, all your kids get up and show them your beautiful outfit. Now who's, I don't know what character she is, what is she? Oh, she's an awful pretty princess. And you're Woody's girlfriend. And I know what a marshmallow is. And Winnie the Pooh down there. What's he do? He's
dressed regular.
He's dressed regular. Well, he's going to be a pumpkin if Lori has anything to do about it on Halloween. And here we have a skeleton. Have you ever... Oh, my gosh. Have you ever had a crazy dream or just dream about someone last night I dreamed about Janie Curley's grandson, and I dreamed that, I didn't know he could sing, but I dreamed that he sang the Star Spangled Banner and everyone got up and just clapped. So maybe someday he can come and sing the Star Spangled Banner and make my dream come true. But, you know, do you like
to play basketball, I know.
Well, Zach was out playing basketball and his dad hollered at him and he says, you ready to go to the homeless shelter to help feed the people? And he says, I've changed my mind. I don't want to go. And his dad says, well, what made you change your mind? And he says, well, Doug told me that it's crazy to go help those people because if they'd get a job, they could help themselves and feed themselves. They wouldn't have to be in a homeless shelter. And he pitched the ball up again and it went through the hoop. And his dad said, didn't you need help when you first started playing basketball? And he says, Coach Perkins worked with you every day to help you get your shotgun. He says, yeah, I know. He says, a lot of the other boys didn't want me to make the team and they wanted the coach to just dump me. And he got to thinking and he thought, when I needed help, Coach Perkins helped me. And now that I'm on the ball team, and he says, I really should go and help with the homeless shelter because anything we do for the least, we do it for Jesus. So let's remember, anything we can do to help someone last week, let's do it, and we'll be doing it for Jesus. Okay? Dear Jesus, help us to help someone in need this week. And we all need a smile, no matter whether we're having heartache or good times. Give a smile to someone this week and spread love that you give us. In your holy name we pray. Amen.
We'll be reunited together at one point when Jesus returns. And so we've kind of created this tradition of lighting candles in memory of someone that we have missed or lost. And so we're going to take some time for us to be able to reflect and to remember the people we love, and then we'll join together in prayer after a bit of time. So I'm going to light our first candle, and I did things a little different this time. Because in the past we've had problems with the lighter, so I have these little beeswax candles, and so you can pick one of those up and use that to light another candle so you don't have to worry about whether or not you can click the lighter. But if you are grieving a loss, it doesn't have to be necessarily a loss of life. Could be changes,
in plans, in dreams. If you are grieving, if you are remembering, this is a chance for us to take that time together today. So if you have someone in mind, I invite you to come light a candle in their memory, and we'll have a chance to remember that we will be reunited again. Join me in remembering. I know the Christian gospel is a joyful one. It's one of hope, right? But I also think it's important for us to remember that when Lazarus died, Jesus cried as well. He recognized the pain of death for those of us that are still here, even though he was going to resurrect Lazarus. In just a few minutes, he still cried. Grief is a holy thing, and there's space in our faith to also have grief. So we take this time, and I'm lighting some candles for those of you who maybe weren't ready to come up, or for the ones that were not ready to light. But as I light these, we're going to take a moment to pray and to remember those that we miss. And to celebrate that there is hope in our, even in our grief, that we will be reunited again. Gracious God, we take this time now to pour our hearts out to you. We grieve people we have lost, even in the midst of knowing there's hope to see them again. Right now we ache. We ache to see them, to hold them, to talk to them one last time. And so, Lord, we take this moment to hand you our grief. to thank you for the gift of the love of these relationships we have had, and to leave with hope in reunions and restorations and redemptions, and that you intend for good. So even in our grief, we can look towards hope. God, we love you and we thank you. In your name we pray, amen.
This time we'll have our prayer requests. Are there those that we need to add this week or those that we can take away?
You can take Kirsten off the list. Praise the Lord. She is doing much better. So thank you.
Dick had a CAT scan, and hopefully we'll find out some results and we'll get the bleeding stopped.
Yes, we hope so.
The candle was for my brother-in-law, and my sister is in an Alzheimer's unit. So pray for her.
Any others? Heavenly Father, we ask that the names that we have mentioned today, those that are just in our hearts or in our thoughts, that you would be with them. If it be thy will, Lord, we ask that you put your healing hand upon them. We ask that you be with their families, with their friends, the caregivers, the doctors, just everyone, and all of those who have gone before us, Lord. Grateful of their memories and the times we had with them and for the foundations that they have laid for us today. And we ask that you continue to be with Israel and the fighting that is going on there, with Ukraine, with Russia, and with the whole world. We are all your children, and we just ask for peace and love, for healing, and for forgiving. And continue to bless this great nation, and let us remember that we are a nation under God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. If you would, please join me in saying the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Thank you.
Our scripture reading for today comes from Matthew 22. This is verses 34 through 46. When the Pharisees heard that Jesus had left the Sadducees speechless, they met together. One of them, a legal expert, tested him. "Teacher, what is the greatest commandment in law?" He replied, "You must love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your being, and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment, and the second is like it. You must love your neighbor as yourself. All the law and the prophets depend on these two commands." Now, as the Pharisees were gathering, Jesus asked them, "What do you think about the Christ? Whose son is he?" "David's son," they replied. He said, "Then how is it that David, inspired by the Holy Spirit, called him Lord when he said, 'The Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right side until I turn your enemies into your footstool.'
If David calls him Lord, how can he be David's son? Nobody was able to answer him, and from that day forward, nobody dared to ask him anything. What motivates you to get out of bed each day?
Food,
kids, those are honest, honest statements. Maybe it's pets demanding to potty or to be fed. Coffee, yeah, coffee is a good reason to get out of bed each day. It's funny to think about motivation. Some of us, it's just like, well, that's just what you do. You wake up, you get up, you know? I envy people who don't have to think about a motivation, like, and are just able to get up. Through my own personal exploration, in the topics of ADHD and autism, I've learned of a phrase that has to do with motivation called executive dysfunction. The general premise of this is that your motivator is broke, okay? That doesn't mean you don't want to do the thing. It's that your motivator, your get up and go, is broke. Now I can hear your thoughts. Isn't that just laziness? No, these are considered different things. Because laziness, you're like, I'll do it later. I don't want to. As opposed to executive dysfunction being the desire, the awareness that you need to do the thing, you want to take care of it, but you just can't get up and do it. There are some people in the world that struggle with executive dysfunction. If you are not one of them, I envy you. that sometimes the motivator is really the thing that can get you out of bed and everything. Stevie is an excellent motivator, mostly because if you're sleeping, she will slap you on the face until you get up and do what she wants. Like, I want my diaper changed. I want food, whatever. Like, she's my external motivator right there. But today, our passage, as we continue in this 1 Thessalonians series, Paul is going to talk about motivation. And while maybe you don't struggle with executive dysfunction, we may find interest in the motivation of our faith and the conversation that maybe we've never had about that. We're going to investigate that together today. So I invite you to turn with me as we go to 1 Thessalonians chapter 2. We're going to look at verses 1 through 8 together. As you yourselves know, brothers and sisters, our visit with you wasn't a waste of time. On the contrary, we had the courage through God to speak God's good news in spite of a lot of opposition, although we had already suffered and were publicly insulted in Philippi, as you know. Our appeal isn't based on false information, the wrong motives, or deception. Rather, we have been examined and approved by God to be trusted with the good news, and that's exactly how we speak. We aren't trying to please people, but we are trying to please God, who continues to examine our hearts. As you know, we've never used flattery, and to God as our witness, we didn't have greedy motives. We didn't ask for special treatment from people, not from you or from others. Although we could have thrown our weight around as Christ's apostles. Instead, we were gentle with you like a nursing mother caring for our own children. We were glad to share not only God's good news with you, but also our very lives because we cared for you so much. Last week, as we were opening up our series, we heard about the rumors of the Thessalonians, that Paul praises them for their faith and how they have this faithful reputation. that the word that's spreading about them was that their faith was active and that it was preceding them. Now we see Paul transition his conversation. He's still going to celebrate them, and if you keep reading in this same chapter, you'll see more of that. But as he's celebrating, he's also reminding them of motivation, like why we do the thing we do. And as he's talking about motivation, he points to the fact that he's been going through some tough stuff. He casually mentions Philippi and the opposition there. And there's questions about scholars have about what exactly he's referring to, but a lot of scholars think it's in reference to Acts 16, where Paul and his companions, they go into Philippi and they're met with opposition and they get beaten and arrested and experience that struggle just for preaching the gospel. They're not doing anything crazy. They're just preaching the gospel. People are like, we're not okay with that. Let's take care of these guys. Now, most of us in our right mind, if we experienced pain or opposition, we might stop doing the thing that's causing the pain or opposition. When I was little, if we were hurt, my dad would tell us, if you quit doing that, it will quit hurting. Like, thanks, Dad. Thanks for that. You know? I feel like that's the natural progression that we may have, unless our motivation pushes us past the pain. Athletes and their desire to improve their time, or I think golfers, they want to improve their strokes. I don't know. You can tell I know nothing about sports. I do know that rugby is basically football without any protective gear. So I do know that. Like, they don't have helmets or padding or anything. Like, they just... And they have a bigger football. It's, yeah. So, brownie points to rugby players. I guess they're tougher than football players.
If rugby was easy, they would have called it football.
Yeah. If rugby was easy, they'd call it football. That's what Eric just said. But there's motivation. When you have a good motivation, you push past whatever discomfort there is to improve, right? And so Paul here is saying, I have a motivation to keep going and sharing the gospel, even when I'm beaten and imprisoned and am dealing with animosity. I am motivated to continue to serve the gospel. He also, we didn't read this today, but if you keep reading in chapter 2, in verse 13, Paul commends them, the Thessalonians, for their faith and says, I see good motivation inside of you. I see that positive inspiration for what you do and why you do the things you do. That they welcomed the message of the gospel openly and fully and recognized it as God's truth and not man's truth. And I have to say, I don't think we always think about the motivation of the church. And it's important for us to ponder this because, to be honest, there are deceivers that clothe themselves like a Christian, but their motivations are not Christ. You'll hear people who preach on television, and their goal is for you to give them money, you know, and when you search things out, you realize, oh, they bought a second private jet, or they have another mansion that they're using that money for. And they're saying, well, God benefited me. Like, God showed me favor because I'm spreading the gospel. But Paul's showing very clearly that our motivation for being Christ followers should not be the way our pockets get lined. Health and wealth is not our motivation. Clout or power is not our motivation for following the gospel. Our motivation to follow Christ should be based on who Christ is. And If you are an American Baptist pastor, when you get ordained, you have to sign this code of ethics. There are a few people in the room that are familiar with this, and one of the pieces of our code of ethics make sure that we are motivated properly. Well, the whole thing really is, but one of it says that we cannot seek benefits for ourselves, for our own personal gain. Like, we can't go to a car dealership and say, hey, you got any discounts for pastors? You know, which I think is a good rule. Like, you know, you shouldn't be go into the clergy world looking for how you could benefit yourself, like either socially or politically or anything like that. Because the Christian faith isn't a social club. It's not fire insurance. So what exactly is supposed to be our motivator? Well, our scripture reading for today said the motivator is to love God and love others. And that all the law and the prophets are based on this. That's the core of the gospel, is that God's not trying to be a fun sucker to remove all the joy in our lives, but wants there to be love flourishing. If love doesn't motivate us, I don't know what will. What's fascinating is recently there's been some talk because there's a Christian magazine called Christianity Today, and the editor recently came out and was talking about how he interviewed this pastor. And this pastor was doing a sermon, like you do, and didn't quote the scripture, but he started paraphrasing the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus' Beatitudes, blessed are the poor, blessed are the peacemakers, blessed are the meek. And people started walking out of the church. He was paraphrasing and they were furious. Somebody comes up to him and says, what's with this liberal agenda that you're trying to share here? And the pastor's like, these are the words of Jesus. He's like, well, that sounds weak. That can't work today. It's a different time. You gotta change the lesson. If that's our heart, what are we motivated for? Why are we showing up if the message of Jesus has all of a sudden become weak and politicized? Jesus was outside of politics, though his behavior influenced it. But that shouldn't be our motivation. Paul celebrates the Thessalonians for their genuine faith and the actions they do, and Paul talks about pressing on in their faith regardless of the circumstances. So my question for us is, how honest are we about our motivation? And as we think about this, I want to think about what liberty claims that we claim we say we're going to be. If you haven't grabbed one of these when this is our part of our Constitution, if you didn't grab one of these when you grabbed a bulletin, Chris has copies of them. I want you to have a chance to see these, so Chris is going to pass these out. But in our Constitution, we have a statement. It's rather wordy and it's older in language, but it's a statement about why we gather together and what we do, what we're supposed to do. And when I look at this, I like what it says. How about I read it for us? So Chris is once again going to keep passing out papers, and you'll eventually get one, okay? So technically, we're supposed to read this before the business meetings where we elect officers. Every time we elect officers, we're supposed to read this. I don't think in my nearly 6 years we have ever done that, but there's a first time for everything. Here's the covenant. As we trust, we have been brought by divine grace to embrace the Lord Jesus Christ, and by the influence of the Holy Spirit to give ourselves up to him, so we do now solemnly covenant with each other that God, enabling us We will walk together in brotherly love, that we will exercise a Christian care and watchfulness over each other and faithfully warn, rebuke, and admonish one another as the case shall require, that we will not forsake the assembling of ourselves together nor omit the great duty of prayer both for ourselves and for others, that we will participate in each other's joys and endeavor with tenderness and sympathy to bear with each other's burdens and sorrows, that we will earnestly endeavor to bring up such as may be under our care in the nurture and admonition of the Lord, that we will seek divine aid to enable us to walk circumspectly and watchfully in the world, denying ungodliness and every worldly lust, that we will strive together for the support of a faithful evangelical ministry among us, that we will endeavor by example and effort to win souls to Christ and through life amidst evil rapport and good rapport, seek to live to the glory of Him who hath called us out of darkness into His marvelous light. That was a lot, right? Before every business meeting where we elect our officers, we're supposed to read this. But I think the intention was good behind this because it reminds us what we're doing. How are we doing at fulfilling what's on this thing?
Remind me what's on there.
Well, there's exercising Christian care for each other, keeping each other accountable. Yeah, spreading the gospel, resisting worldly desires. So living differently, pursuing prayer, caring for each other in brotherly love. I think about those things and, in essence, we're doing well at a lot of these, but then the more practical ones, we might be struggling with. And I think about this specifically because, does everybody know what committee they're on? Do you know what committee you're serving? You can move forward one, Bailey, or to the Liberty Organization one. I want to offer some solutions for us, or some, like a trajectory to go towards. Now, one of the ways that we've heard, I have heard that executive dysfunction is battled well, is by doing something called body doubling, which basically means doing your tasks with somebody else around doing their task. Like, does anybody really thrive there? We don't need to talk, we don't need to do anything else, or do anything together. Like, if you're doing your thing, I can do my thing, and we'll just motivate each other. That's what committees are supposed to be. Helping the church do the thing. We have a committee, and we gather, and we help accomplish the goals of the church. And so Liberty committees, at least the ones I'm on, I think the only one that I know of that has met in the last at least 6 months is the Pastoral Relations Committee. This, woo, Bailey's like, yeah, look at us go. We're pretty great. Shout out to Cecilia for organizing them. Yeah?
Special events.
Oh, special events?
Oh, yeah, we do a lot.
Christy's not looking very convincing. She's like, yeah, we definitely did that. We had special events, yes. But I think sometimes we have a tough time doing the things, meeting as committees, because we don't remember why we do them. We have vacancies in our committees. And a lot of that is because people don't understand, well, what's the point of doing this? I mean, I see what the bylaw says, but what's my motivation to show up for this? And so we come back to Paul's words that our inspiration, that our motivation is the fact that God designed the world to foster love. So, if you're unsure about what committee you're on, I have a list here. I'm not going to post this up because I have notes on it, because this is an old one. But we have lots of vacancies, and then we also have hopes and dreams for the church moving forward. Two of them, well, really three of them being, I'm looking for people for 2024 to be sermon subs. So for the times that I am gone, that people in the church learn how to prepare a sermon and have one sermon that they're ready to use while I am gone. The deacons will be prepped on that, but I'd love a couple others to also participate. I know Lori Hoback has done it before, and she survived.
Yeah, I'll do it.
Yeah. So if you move forward a couple slides, I'll get back to that. So one of the things is looking for sermon subs. If that's something that maybe you would like to learn about, you don't have to commit to a date when we do this, but we'll talk about picking a passage and how to figure out what to say about it. Another is we're looking to include students in our music team, either playing piano for offertories or things, or singing alongside Abby or myself. So if you have somebody, adults are invited too, but no adult has jumped on this yet. So, if you know a kid or an adult interested in joining us, let us know. And the one that's on the top of this list is what's called the Deacon's Apprentice. And this is an idea for that transition point for our tweens, because that's when the drop-off point kind of starts to happen. They get a little too old for children's church, but also, man, that pastor's boring. I get it. And we're looking to develop a system for like a mentorship where they learn hands-on what it's like to follow Jesus, so that they would follow the deacons. They would be helping with things like the chaos that was lighting the candles today. Thanks, Gerard, for helping out with that. Or prepping communion. I'll even teach them how to make the old school communion bread so that they can be in charge of that. But the idea that they get to be hands-on and have some intense lessons. We're not just wanting to do these things because we want to be busy work. And Liberty's not trying to be a big mega church, right? But we are called to foster the development of love and community. And I'm asking you to reflect on what your motivation is. Are you sitting in this pew because it's just a social club and you're glad to see each other? Or is it because you're called to know Jesus more and to live like Jesus? Are you compelled to be transformed by his truth and his teachings? We don't do stuff to earn God's favor. We talked about that last week. God already loves us, regardless of what our faith reputation is. But I do have the question, what is our true motivation? And are we inspired to do what we are called to do accordingly? Not for financial gain, not for spiritual clout, but our motivation to be rooted in the love we have received from God and the inspiration to share it with others. Let's get back to work. Gracious God, it's really easy to lose our way, to get full of the to-dos, of our week and set aside things that feel non-essential or non-pressing. We deprioritize our spiritual health for the world outside. Work, and the responsibilities there, the responsibilities of our home, of family, of friends, of our chores. And we need you to ground us. Bring us back to center on you and to find our motivation in your truth. And let that motivation help us to pursue and endure even when things get hard. God, we love you and we thank you. In your name we pray, amen. I invite you to stand with us as we sing our closing benediction. And when we do this, I'm also going to bless our food. There's gonna be hot dogs, coney sauce, chili, baked potatoes, whole bunch of things. So there's lots of options to eat in there. And we'll bless that and be able to celebrate together after this. To serve the gospel, to love God and love others. And may the food we're about to eat bless and nourish our bodies so that we are motivated to serve you. God, we love you and we thank you. In your name we pray. Amen. All right, let's go have some fun.